Hello, I'm Rachel. I'm curator of natural history at the Powell-Cotton Museum and also project manager for Colonial Critters, reinterpreting historical natural history dioramas with modern audiences. Today I'm firstly going to give you a very brief overview of the history of the Powell-Cotton Museum in case you're not familiar with us and to put this project into context. I'll then talk about Colonial Critters itself, why we're doing it and what we'll be doing. I'll then finish with a few brief thoughts on what I think decolonisation means to us at the Powell-Cotton Museum. The museum was founded by Percy Horace Gordon Powell-Cotton, who was a keen hunter, traveller and collector. He made a number of hunting trips to India and different parts of Africa between 1889 and 1939, collecting both animals and cultural objects. I've highlighted on the map the African countries that he spent time in. You can see that he travelled quite widely, and he particularly spent a lot of time in East and Central Africa in areas under European colonial control, but not just within the British Empire. The only nation he visited that wasn't under European control at the time was Ethiopia. Here it was King Menelik II he had to negotiate with for hunting access. He built a museum in the grounds of his family home at Quex Park in the village of Birchington-on-Sea in East Kent to house his collection. The natural history collection comprises around 6,500 mammals and smaller numbers of birds, reptiles, amphibians and invertebrates. The natural history material on display is mainly taxidermy. The museum houses 8 large-scale habitat dioramas across 3 galleries, which were built between 1896 and 1939, with taxidermy by Roland Wards. The dioramas showcase the diversity of animals and landscapes that Percy saw on his travels. We also have some trophy heads, mounted skulls, and elephant ivory on display in these galleries, as well as some of the cultural objects that Percy collected. These 3 galleries are the only ones built during Percy's lifetime. He died in 1940, shortly after the 3rd was completed. Other members of his family added additional galleries to the museum over the following decades, displaying the family's collections of world cultures, archaeology, and ceramics. We also have an extensive archive of notes, letters, photographs, film footage, receipts, and more. Percy Powell-Cotton was a very detail-focused man, and kept basically every piece of paper he ever scribbled on. This archive is an amazing research resource and will be invaluable to the Colonial Critters project. So that was a very quick history, but I think it gives you a glimpse of the colonial nature of the museum and its collections. The aim of the Colonial Critters project is to research the history of the dioramas and produce new interpretation for the natural history galleries, which will be informed by conversation with our audiences, and also non-audiences, those who don't currently visit. We will be refreshing the stories that we tell about the museum and introducing a diversity of voices to the displays. The museum has a very colonial gaze, centering the views and experiences of one wealthy, privileged, white European man. In focusing exclusively on the Powell-Cotton story, the voices of the hundreds, if not thousands, of people across many African nations, in India and in Kent, who have contributed to the history of the museum, have been suppressed. The Powell-Cotton is still very much the museum of the great white hunter. And we have to ask ourselves, is that what we want to be? Is that relevant to our current audiences? And what about the communities who don't currently visit, because the museum's a very uncomfortable place for them? Colonial Critters falls under a programme of works we're calling Reimagining the Museum, which encompasses a number of projects across the site. It's about returning context to the past through our interpretation and engagement, and working with our communities to be equitable, honest and transparent moving forwards. The other projects that form part of Reimagining the Museum include the first contemporary collecting of cultural materials that the museum has done in decades, working with Kwanyama craftspeople in Namibia. We'll also be rethinking how we use some of our galleries and developing our Victorian walled garden to enable more community involvement. While we're undertaking this programme of works, which also includes some essential building repairs, the museum will be closed for general admission for the next 2 years. However, we will be running a programme of events around the various themes of reimagining the museum during this time. The Colonial Critters project basically consists of three strands. The first is archival research to look into the history of the museum, its collections, and the people with whom Percy worked, both across the world and locally in Kent, to make this place. We'll also be doing research into the life histories and afterlives of some of the key animals on display, to be able to tell their stories too. Documentation should be part of any project, as far as I'm concerned, and during Colonial Critters we will be fully documenting all of the natural history material that's on display and making more information available online. I'm also looking at ways that we can decolonise our cataloguing processes and have started making a few changes to our database so that we can better record information about Indigenous hunters and collectors and also record the names of animals in different languages to begin to decenter Western taxonomy. I'd like to do this in the galleries as well, using different local names of animals and also places, rather than just the standard English common names and scientific names, which, if we're being entirely honest, have little meaning to many of our visitors anyway. The third aspect of the project is public engagement. We're currently in the process of recruiting an audience development consultant to help us build relationships with community groups and run focus groups to find out what people want to see in the museum in the future. We're also planning to develop a pop-up museum that we can take to local events in the summers to bring the project to people while the museum is closed, COVID restrictions dependent, of course. We're also going to run short research projects with community groups and university students to get them directly involved in the research process, and we'll be using a community-led approach. Colonial Critters was originally due to start in April 2020, but due to COVID-19 was delayed until September. We've really only just started work on the project, and we'll be kicking off the public-facing aspects properly at the start of 2021. We've set ourselves some interpretive principles for this project. First and foremost, we won't be changing or removing the dioramas. They're important historical objects in their own right. So the galleries won't actually look that different when we've finished. The displays themselves will stay the same, but the interpretation will change. At the moment, the gallery text is a mixture of what you can call Percy adventure stories, I guess, and some fairly dry information about biology and ecology, and all the text is overly long and hard to read. We're going to introduce a mixture of animal and people-focused stories into the galleries, but also into the museum more broadly in other ways. We've decided that not every story needs to be on a text panel. We'll also be creating new themed gallery tours and online content, and the research generated during this project will feed into family activities and schools programmes. This project is a bit of a testing bed for us. We haven't done this kind of formalised and intensive audience engagement and development work before, so it's going to be a very interesting journey. Colonial Critters is scheduled to take 2.5 years. I think it's important to note that we don't see this project as an end point. Right, we've decolonised that now. But a beginning. It takes time to build trust and relationships with communities and to bring about lasting organisational change. This project will start us on the road to setting our future agenda as an institution. So, lastly, a few thoughts on decolonisation. We're actually trying not to use the term decolonisation now when we talk to the public about what we're doing. It's an unfamiliar word to some people and it can be misunderstood. Like many museums, we put out statements around Black Lives Matter and decolonisation in the wake of the police killing of George Floyd in the US. And the only really negative feedback we had from this came from people who didn't quite get what we meant. They were worried that we'd be ripping out all the dioramas and completely changing the museum, which of course we're not going to do. There's also some debate within the sector about whether decolonisation is the correct term for what we're doing. Tuck and Yang stated that decolonisation brings about the repatriation of Indigenous land and life. They argued that the discourse of decolonising has been adopted to describe other forms of social justice work, which turns it into a metaphor and can itself be a form of settler appropriation that recenters whiteness. If museums aren't repatriating cultural or natural heritage, or doing other direct reparative work, Are we really decolonising? Culture and have produced a Black Lives Matter charter for the UK heritage sector, which I think is a really useful resource. It contains practical steps that museums can take to decolonise and to ensure that their pledged commitment to Black Lives Matter is not just lip service. And the charter isn't just about collections, it's also about diversifying the workforce and supporting Black communities, which must be an integral part of decolonising efforts in the sector. So, what does decolonisation, if that's what we're going to call it, mean to the Powell-Cotton Museum? It means acknowledging the past and not making excuses for it. It's not good enough anymore to say that Powell-Cotton was of his time. And it also means acknowledging that the past is not in the past, that people and populations of animals are still affected by the legacies of colonialism today. For example, this is reflected heavily in modern conservation policies in many parts of the world. It also means making space for a diversity of voices and views, and working with communities to enable them to tell their own stories rather than just being subjects. I seem to have used the word community a lot in this presentation, but that really is what's at the heart of decolonising for us. People matter. We want the Powell-Cotton to be for everyone, and for the museum to be a more collaborative, inclusive community space. So that's all from me. If you'd like to know more about the Colonial Critters project, do please get in touch. Our email is collections@powell-cottonmuseum.org. Thank you very much.
Thank you ever so much, Rachel. That was a really interesting talk and really powerful stuff you're doing at the Powell-Cotton, and definitely one to watch in the next few years. It looks like we've got a question. So interesting to hear Rachel say that decolonising might not be the best term to use when talking to the public. Do you think that we need different terminology for the process of decolonisation to avoid the politics?
I don't think it's about avoiding politics necessarily. Everything is political, you know. It is impossible to avoid. But I think it's sometimes about choosing your wording carefully to make what you're doing inclusive. Decolonizing sounds scary to people. It sounds like a negative thing. It sounds like, you know, deconstruction, decolonize. It sounds like you're tearing things down and removing things and rewriting history and all of these accusations that get thrown around quite a lot. So it has value as a term. Obviously, it, you know, does describe quite well what we're doing. But in terms of public comms, sometimes I think it's about kind of picking your battles a little bit and just thinking about what we're saying. Make it clear that what we're doing is not rewriting history or, you know, removing things. We are adding to the history of the museum. We aren't doing anything that's negative. It's all additive. It's adding value to the experience and adding to the inclusiveness of the place.
Thank you, Rachel. So just to say, in a moment, I'm very happy to take questions for any of the panellists, if you've got any in mind. But we've got another question, if you're happy to take it, for you, Rachel. Obviously, reinterpreting existing displays is brilliant, but will there be any additional objects put on display to tell these narratives in other ways, not centred around a European hunter?
Potentially. We haven't really got into what the new kind of interpretation and displays are going to look like. We're still at very early stages of the project, but we are very keen that the natural history displays and the world cultures displays tie in together to tell the same narrative. We have, you know, both types of material are on display in the same galleries, so potentially we could use some of the world cultures material to help to tell the stories about the natural history displays as well. We have a collection of, you know, weapons and things like that that would be used in hunting, so potentially we could use both, but we do have limited display space. So we're going to have to come up with some quite creative solutions, I think, for how to make all of this work.
Brilliant. Thank you, Rachel. We honestly very much look forward to seeing what happens in the next few years.